300 years ago, something really big happened. The Western world began to look at the world with new scientific eyes. There was a problem with this, though. As scientists began to classify the world into different categories, they also began to divide the human species into subspecies. Because of this, an authoritative justification of slavery and colonialism happened. People have suffered because of this for over 300 years, and while many people back in the day argue that the dominance of Europeans was because its race was superior to those of Africa, China, the Americas, etc., the truth is that their power really came from luck. Thought Monkey here. This episode is all about outlining a theory that tries to explain why Europeans have been so dominant over the past 500 years. In 1997, a man named Jared Diamond published a book called Guns, Germs, and Steel. The book was inspired by a question that a new Guinean man named Yali asked him. One day, Yali asked Diamond, "Why is it that you white people developed so much cargo and brought it to New Guinea, but we black people had little cargo of our own?" Diamond spends his book answering this question. He details evidence that points to the environment rather than biological differences between different groups of people for their success. He goes back over 13,000 years to discover why the West, rather than the East, Africa, or the Native Americans, have dominated the world. The argument that he points to is that European dominance is a result of opportunity and necessity rather than any kind of particular ingenuity. That there was a chain of events that led them to the position they are in now. If we go back far enough into history, we can look at these developments. The road to such inequality began when people stopped being hunter-gatherers and started being farmers. When this happened, people didn't have to spend all their time looking for food to eat and instead could plant, harvest, and store a surplus of food. With enough food stored, people can have free time to do stuff like build cities, develop states, and consolidate those states into empires. It's not quite as easy as it sounds, however. A number of factors must be in your favor in order to make the transition from hunting and gathering to farming. First, you have to have crops that are high in nutrients which can also be stored. And you need a climate that is dry enough that will allow storage. You also need animals that can be domesticated by humans and used to help with the farming process. When you have control of these things, you can make extra food which can be used to feed lots of people who can then grow the population, learn other things, and innovate socially and technologically. At this point, societies start to become hierarchical and political structures develop that lead to nations being built. The problem with most places around the world is that they just are not suitable for the first step in building a civilization. They simply can't develop a system of agriculture based on their environment. On the other hand, Europe and Asia, which we will call Eurasia, was perfect. It had a relatively dry climate and lots of plants and animals that could be domesticated. For example, it had barley, two kinds of wheat, beans, flax, goats, sheep, cattle, donkeys, horses, and more. Diamond discovered that while Eurasia had 14 animals that were able to be used by humans and domesticated, there was only one in South America, the llama, and none in all other parts of the world. Some might argue that zebras and African elephants could be domesticated, but zebras have been found over and over again to be untamable. And while African elephants are tameable, they are nearly impossible to breed in captivity. It is also probably true that both North America and Australia had animals at one point that could be domesticated, but due to what looks like overhunting, both regions lost any animals that could be used by humans. Another key in explaining the dominance of Europe is disease, and animal domestication had a lot to do with this. Many of the diseases that have wiped out enormous populations in Europe and Asia are a consequence of people living in close proximity with animals. Diseases like smallpox, measles, and influenza all come from living close to animals. Over hundreds of years, exposure to these diseases have allowed Eurasians to develop resistances toward them. As they traveled, they also took these diseases wherever they went. And when they came into contact with people who had never been exposed to them, the deaths of millions resulted. Eurasia's geographical location also promoted cultural exchange between its people in a way that the rest of the world lacked. The fact that it stretches west to east instead of north to south like the Americas and Africa do allowed for a greater variety of plants and animals that could be domesticated to be exchanged. It also allowed its people to trade both innovations and diseases more easily than a north to south continent. Let me explain. By being oriented west to east, domesticated breeds in one part of the continent could be used in another location on that continent due to the seasons and climate being relatively similar. On the other hand, the Americas and Africa are both geographically fragmented. In the Americas, it proved difficult for crops to be adapted from one latitude to another, and in North America, from one side of the Rocky Mountains to the other. Traveling from North America to South America without modern-day planes and boats was also definitely a bitch. Africa's extreme variations in environment also made it pretty much impossible to use domesticated plants and animals from different locations. Unlike these two places, Europeans were able to adopt the animals and plants of Southwest Asia and their agricultural techniques over thousands of years ago. By 1000 CE, pretty much all of Europe had adopted the plants and methods of Southwest Asia. Because societies in Eurasia were able to produce a crop surplus and develop cities, people were able to specialize in skills outside of basic survival. People like craftsmen and scribes made Eurasian societies grow economically and technologically much faster than hunters and gatherers. These advantages eventually led the people of one part of Eurasia, Europe, to conquer the world using technological advances like guns and steel. Some might ask why it was the European powers rather than the Asian powers of Eurasia who dominated the world. After all, China has historically been one of the most powerful and stable places in the world. Diamond proposes that there are geographical explanations. In Europe, there are lots of natural barriers like mountains, rivers, the sea, etc., which allow societies to develop independently of each other. At the same time, competition between these societies were massive and ensured that those who didn't develop quickly would soon be conquered. In other words, it was a sort of natural selection of societies. Only the most economically and militarily advanced societies survived. Unlike in Europe, Asia had large isolated empires, which deprived them of as much competition and led to policies that sometimes hindered their economic development. One example is when China banned ocean-going ships in the 16th century, just as the Europeans were beginning to explore and colonize the world. Western Europe also benefited from a mild climate that was suitable for agriculture. In Southwest Asia, or what we sometimes call the Middle East, intense agriculture eventually damaged the environment enough that the desertification of the region was encouraged. Even today, as the world has entered a more globalized era, the difference in wealth and power is huge between the people who have descended from the Western Europeans and everyone else. In fact, if you look at a list of the richest people in the world, the majority are American or European. Most of us don't stop to think about it, but the consequences of geographical and environmental luck have had a lasting impact on each and every one of our lives today. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button below, and you can click the button in the middle of the screen to subscribe and stay updated with the latest Thought Monkey video.